the name that has no rival, the name that has no equal, a matchless name. Name of Jesus, I ask you to break chains tonight. Strongholds are broken by the sound of your name, hallelujah. There is power in the name of Jesus, hallelujah. There's some things that's holding you back. God does not want you to be bound. He does not want you to be tied up. He does not want anything not of Him to have a stronghold on you. I declare depression, that bond to just be broken, that chain to just be broken. Anxiety, I declare it broken tonight. I declare any sickness, disease, those chains, I declare them broken by the name of Jesus tonight. His name is so powerful. That name of Jesus frees you up. And if you're watching and you're sitting at home and you know this is you, that you need this, just go ahead and declare the name of Jesus over your life. I declare the name of Jesus over my life. I am not bound. this world, but I am free. Hallelujah. When I think about the Lord and how he saved me and how he raised me and how he filled me with the Holy Ghost and how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord and how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground. When I think about the Lord and how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled
foundation. And as she was singing that, I thought, thank you, Jesus, for that solid foundation. When we're a child of God and we stand on his word, it's solid. We want to welcome you to Thursday Night Recharge. We are so excited to be coming into your homes or wherever you're watching tonight. And we're excited about the word. I believe that those songs that Haley just shared and Tyler shared just plowed open the field for that seed to be planted into our hearts tonight. I know today I was making some phone calls, just checking on some of our church people, church members, and happened to call a girl and wanted to check on her little boy. It comes to my Sunday school. And she told me, she said, you just called me at the right time. There's so much going on, and thank you for calling. It was just a God thing. And maybe tonight this program is just a God thing for you because you've got some things going on, and you just need some peace. I told her, sit down. Let God speak peace into your home and into your life. And maybe that's what God is saying to you tonight. Let him speak peace into your heart, into your situation, into what you're going through. Because we know that when you allow him to get involved in your situation, everything turns out just fine. I was reading in the scripture today where it says he even goes before us. Not only is he with us, but he goes before us. He makes the way for us. And those are some good promises right there when you know Jesus is with you and he has gone before you. And tonight our prayer is that you will allow him to minister to you. It doesn't matter how good Haley sings or how wonderful Tyler plays that keyboard or how good Pastor Don brings the word. If you don't allow it to become part of you and allow it to fix and move in the situation that you're encountering, whether it's a healing. I know Sister Linda's sister needs a healing tonight. There's a friend of mine, Donna, she buried her husband today. There's a lot going on, but God is the peace giver. He can work, he can give you peace in those situations. So just let it minister to you tonight. That's what we're here for, is to minister to you right there in your home, wherever you're at. Last Saturday, Pastor Don and I were privileged to go to Columbus, Ohio, and pray with some of the saints up there. They came to the church to allow us to pray with them. And as we were praying with them, I said, tell me what God's been doing for you. Any testimonies? And oh my goodness, the testimonies that people started sharing with us. One lady said, I hadn't gotten my check. I hadn't gotten my unemployment. And she said, I got a knock on the door. And I went to the door and didn't really know the lady, but I knew she lived a couple doors down. And she handed me a check. And she said, I looked at it, it was $1,500. And she said, oh, thank you, thank you. And the lady says, no, don't thank me, I'm just being obedient. How many knows? God knows how to speak. He knows where you're at. He knows what you have need of. Another lady told us that she was needing some financial help. And so somebody needed a place to stay. She said, told them they could stay with me for a few days, another lady. And she said, we didn't talk about money. We didn't talk about a charge. And she said, when she moved out, she left me a check for $600. God knows, doesn't he? He knows how to speak. A gentleman told us that he has money coming, things that should have cost way more than what he was told. He got it done for a lot cheaper, like half price. People said, I'm doing better than I was before because they've been faithful to the Lord. And when you're faithful to him, he's faithful to you. Last Tuesday, I listened to the Rooted prayer drive. And someone gave their heart to the Lord through that hour that they're out praying and praying over the city. But Haley gave a challenge. And she said, while we're off and have this time, because we do have time, why don't you do something different? Maybe get up earlier, read your Bible, study, something different. And so the next day, I set a time. That night, I said, God, I want to wake up at this time. But I didn't set the clock. I just went was trusting the Lord to wake me up. And 4 minutes before I was supposed to wake up, my sister texted me and woke me up. And I got up an hour early so I could have an hour longer to read my Bible and to study. So, Haley, the challenge is going forth tonight. Do something so that when the church doors are open, that you come in filled. You come in rejoicing. You come in blessed. You come in with a testimony. Don't come in drained. Spend that time with the Lord right now so that that when you come back, you're blessed and highly favored. And Pastor Don will be wondering, where you been? We know you've been with the Lord. So we know that this Sunday is Mother's Day. And I wanted really, really bad to talk Pastor Don into that this would be the right time to open up the church doors. But we knew the churches would be flooded with people for two reasons. They've been home a long time, and it's Mother's Day. So we decided we're going to wait. But thinking about mothers, I'm a mother. I have three grown children. And if you talk to any of them, I love presents. So I'm not saying I don't want presents. But my kids know I love words, too. So I want to challenge all you grown children and little children to write your mother a very special letter and tell her how much she means to you, that you notice the struggles that she's been through to put food on the table or the struggles she's went through to put clothes on your back, clean clothes. Write her a letter this Mother's Day and make it special, even though we can't all come to church, because you said some beautiful words from your heart to your mother. And, you know, the older your children are, the more those words mean to you because they have memories, so many years of memories with you. So this coming Sunday, which is May the 10th, we will not be having an in-house church. We'll be live streaming. But we are going to invite all the mothers to come to the church in their cars and line up. And I want to give you, along with Pastor Don, a gift, because I believe that one mother can bless another mother. I know what you've been through. I know what you're going through. I know how it feels to be a mother. And Pastor Don would be there in case you need prayer. So this coming Sunday at 12:30, we will be out. We'll already be done with our service. So we'll invite you to come, all you mothers, and get your free gift. Also, we'll be announcing on Sunday during our Sunday morning service when we will reopen Spirit of Truth, Washington Courthouse in Springfield, Ohio. We'll give you a date. We're excited about it. I know everybody's excited about it. So we're praying about that right now, but we will make an announcement on Sunday. Sunday evening at 6:30. Everybody say Sunday at 6:30. Okay. We're going to have a very special live stream service. Pastor Don will be here. I'll be here. And we're going to have some guests. John and Tammy Ogden, they're from right here in Washington Courthouse. But they travel as missionaries in different parts of the world. And they have so many of experiences and testimonies and things that they are going to share with us. And some of you may have a heart to be a missionary. Maybe they can share some things of how they got started and how God called them. But that's this coming Sunday, May the 10th, at our 6:30 p.m. live service. So we want to let you know about that because we know you don't want to miss it. Right now, we're going to give you time to go online or download our app, because we appreciate all the gifts, all the offerings, all the tithe that's coming in. We've been able to pay our bills because people have lifted our hands. They've been faithful. They've been dropping it off, mailing it, going online. We are so proud of the body of Christ because they caught the vision that the church has to go on. The church is essential. So on the screen, you're going to see how you can connect with us to do online giving. So I'm going to give you a moment as we take our online giving offering. Brother Tyler is going to play something. And as soon as we come back, Pastor Don will preach the gospel.
Tyler, love those, the words of that song. It says, I've learned to trust in Jesus, and I've learned to trust in God. I want to talk to you for just a few moments about our Father. 54 years in ministry, I've recognized the need of the presence of my Father. I've recognized the need of the power of the presence of Jesus, the power of the Holy Ghost. And this week, the Lord has really stirred in my heart that He wants a relationship. Father God, your Father. He wants to have a relationship with you like He's never had before. So many times we say, well, you know, we're going to just ask Jesus. Well, no, we ask the Father in Jesus' name or by the authority of Jesus. See, everything comes from the Father. He created all things. We realize that when He created man in His own image, that man failed. When man failed, then time came by and the Father recognized it's time now for me to heal all of my children that have fallen into sin because of Adam and Eve's failure. So he became flesh. God, Father, became flesh to dwell among us. The purpose of Jesus was not just to hang out for 3.5 years in ministry as a full-grown man, but also to do something that only he could do. He was the representation of the Father. The Father became flesh. The flesh manifested the Father's spirit of compassion and love, reached out and healed and delivered all over the country, and then laid down his life so that all men in that time and all future generations could be saved. That's the love of your Father. And I'd never fully realized, I think, in the way that I have this week, that we have to ask ourselves, how close am I to my Father? My earthly father passed when I was 20 years old, just had turned 20 years old, and I'll never forget that. It was a hard time for me because my father was my pastor. He was my mentor, and he was my friend. He was an example to me. He was one that taught me how to be a man. He taught me what's right and wrong and how to obey the law of God. He taught me how to obey the laws and to be what I should be. He taught me. Didn't force me because that can't happen, but he led me and guided me. And I realize now that many of you like me, your father has gone on to his reward, and maybe your mother as well. And even though I don't have my natural mother, I don't have my natural father, I still have my heavenly Father. And you realize that he's not just God in the heavens. Somebody put on the back of one of the trucks the other day, it said, he's not the man upstairs. His name is Jesus. Once you realize it's not about some figure somewhere in the clouds or somewhere far away, you realize that he is everything you need. Let me just say it. God is everything you need. I know we've been going through a couple of months of weird times and struggles and fears and frustration. There seems to be death lurking all around and questions and what about the future and what about my job and what about my family, and all those things seem like they've been compounded in the last couple of months. But let me just tell you this. The Bible said that he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High, he that hangs tight with God, he that has a relationship with God. Saints, I want to say it, no matter how long you've been saved, we need a closer walk with the Lord. We need to know him in a more intimate way. He's not just Father. Now, the other day I was listening to something that reminded me and brought chills to my heart. Some people say, and I think Kathy was talking about it, there's some people when you say, God wants to be your Father, some people cringe because they think Heavenly Father is maybe like their father or a father figure that was not what they should have been. Can I just tell you this right now? We all need a father. Everybody on the planet needs a father. In the last 10, 20 years, we've recognized there's less father than there ever has been. You can hear it on the news. You can hear it everywhere you go. Well, I didn't have a father, or I had an absentee father, or I didn't have that father figure in my life. And because of that, then where are the young men and where are the young ladies going to understand the development that only a father can provide for them? Only a father can give a son some of the things he needs to grow up to be a man. I know right now we recognize there's so many things that have gone awry in the world because we didn't have the training we should have had. Say, well, you know, my father should have taught me that, but I didn't have a father. I'm not trying to put down the father figures. I'm trying to show you something. Your heavenly Father is a perfect father. He is not only God Almighty, but he is a perfect father, and he wants a relationship with you. If you were to ask me what some of my favorite areas of Scripture are in the New Testament, one of them would be, we shared a few weeks ago in Luke, the 15th chapter, and the Lord was revealing to the church world that he's the kind of a God that if you're a lost sheep, he will leave everything behind and go after you until he brings you. That's the kind of a father you have. Then it talks about the woman that lost her coin. She lost her integrity, if you will, in the area of her identity. She lost so much, but once she got back what she had lost, when the Father gives you back and lets you find what you've lost, then life begins fresh all over again. And then the word goes all the way back to my favorite part of Luke 15 and 11, and it said there was a certain man that had two sons. The younger of them said to the father, listen to that, he said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth me. And so the father divided unto his son his living. He gave him his inheritance way too soon. I just got to muddle around through this for a moment because he goes to the father and he asks the father, I want my inheritance. And many great religious leaders have said, in paraphrasing, it could have been said, you're not dying soon enough for me. I want my money now. I want my inheritance. I want the will now. I don't really care about you. I want what you can provide for me. I don't want God to be just one when I'm in need, I go to him. I know he's always been there when I needed an answer, but I don't want to just entertain him when I need him. I want him to be my everything. I want him to be there so I can shout with him when everything is good. I want him to be able to let me appreciate him when everything is wonderful around me and I don't have a need in the world or a care in the world. I want to still hang out with him and want him just as bad when I don't have a need or a pressing sickness or a disease or a problem. I still want him to be in my every moment. I want him to be in my every activity. I want him to be Father. I don't think we've taught very much about this as we probably should have, but we need to understand he loved us so much that he became flesh. Somebody said, well, that's Jesus. Yes, it was God that took on flesh. God became flesh so that he could wipe out sin for all believers. My friend, God wants you. He wants you to come home. God wants a tight relationship with you. We go on to read about the prodigal boy that went away to a far country, and as soon as he got finished wasting his father's inheritance, it wasn't his. His father gave it to him, and he didn't understand it because if you don't work for it, you don't understand that you might quickly lose it, and you don't know how to balance prosperity. The Bible said as soon as he wasted all of his money, a famine came, and he had no food, so he went and hired himself out to a citizen of another country. In other words, he went over to the enemy's camp, to the devil's crowd, and he became like them because he lost everything. And when the Bible said he finally looked around and realized, I would fill my belly with hog food, but nobody will even give me hog food. All the value that I have in life is to feed the swine so that this man that I don't even know that doesn't care about me, this devil example, if you will, he doesn't care about me. He wants to use me to provide for him, to raise up his swine so that he has plenty, but he doesn't care about me. I want to let you know, if you're a child of God, nobody will ever love you like Jesus loves you. I got to tell you this. I've had people that loved me along the journey and over 50 years in ministry, and I've met some wonderful people, and they loved me, and they sacrificed to help me at times, but nobody's ever loved me like my Heavenly Father. And not only did they not only love me like that, because they're not God, they're not able to do that. But there's also another part of this I want you to understand. You got to realize nobody can do for you what only God can do for you. I've had friends that gave me an offering or a helping hand when I was struggling, or helped me to push my car or jumpstart my car or took me someplace or blessed me. But nobody can be my everything. But my Heavenly Father, He is my everything. He's my joy in the morning. He's my peace at night. He is my love. He's my power. He's my sanity. He's my victory. He's every good and perfect gift. He's every wonderful memory. That's what my Father is. Yes, God became flesh so we could see what He was like. The Word became flesh so we could understand He's a healing Jesus. The Word became flesh so He can reach to a woman getting ready to be stoned while she's caught in the act of adultery, but He bypassed the past sin and He reached down to her and said, no, you're not going to continue to live like this, but I'm going to stop your accusers, and I'm going to wash you in precious blood, and I'm going to let you know what God Almighty thinks about you. He never stops loving you when you mess up and fail. Well, then what are you talking about? Anytime there's a broken relationship, it hinders your relationship. It doesn't destroy His love for you. He'll keep on loving you when you're down until you let Him pick you back up. Yes, I said it right. You have to allow Him to pick you up. He's always one step away. He's always there with His hand extended. It doesn't matter how far in sin you've gone. He's right there all the time saying, would you just come home? Will you just let me fix you? That's your Father. Represented by Jesus, everywhere He went, He didn't ask people for stuff. He gave away what the Father had given to Him. I love this so much because sometimes we don't realize how much we're loved. I don't know how much He loves me. I can't fathom the greatness of His love. Somebody says, well, I thought grace was spent. I had failed too many times. I didn't think God would ever be merciful again. And about that time, I needed a miracle of forgiveness, and there He was forgiving me again as though He had never, ever done it before. That's the kind of a Father you have. The Bible said when this young man, we symbolize this by saying he's probably laying in a hog pen somewhere, and that's spiritually where he was, estranged from the Father, but not because the Father wanted him to go. See, the Father can't make you stay home. The Father can't make you stay at His house. The Father can't make you stay in church or hang around believers and Christians and people that are out to help you. You can go away if you want to. He can't make you stay. But He loves you so much in time when you wake up, you'll realize a little bit of how much he loves you and he wants you home. The man we're talking about, this young man, said, you know, when I came to myself, I realized that my father has hired servants, not other sons, but just the hired servants. They've got bread enough and to spare. They're throwing food in the trash, and they have more than they need, and I'm perishing. You know what I realize? I have a father. Why am I doing this? Some of you right now, there's a bondage in your life. As Haley was saying, we need to get rid of all those things that separate us, all those things that hinder us from a glorious relationship with God. He said, you know what? Even the servants have more than I have, and here I am perishing unnecessarily. So notice what he said. He said, I'm going to rise. I'm going to get up, and look at this. I'm going to go back to my father. Even though he didn't fully understand the Father, he didn't understand how much the Father loved him, he realized it's a whole lot better in the Father's house than it is in the devil's house. It's a whole lot better around God's people than it is in the world where it's a killing, destroying, hateful world around us. But I wasn't like that in my father's house. And the Bible said, he said, I think I'm going to go back to my father's house. And this is what I'm going to say. I'm still going to call him Father, though. I want you to hear this. I don't really understand what he's like. I don't appreciate the kind of a father I had. I don't even understand him being that good of a father. But I'm going to go and I'm going to plead mercy with my father. And I'm going to say, I've sinned. That's all God wants you to do is recognize you've sinned, turn around from sin, and go to the Father. He wants you to come home. Then he said, I'm not worthy to be called your son. Father, I'm not worthy. I want to say it right now, even though I'm not worthy on my own to obtain anything that God has, I am worthy because he made me worthy. He wants me. He made us worthy to sit with him in heavenly places. Not my goodness, never, but because his love makes me worthy. So the boy is pleading his case, saying, Father, I'm not worthy to be your son, but would you just hire me? Would you feed me? Out of benevolence, I don't understand how great of a father you are until now. I'm starting to realize I didn't leave home because I was all that. I didn't leave home because I understood all that. I left home because I didn't appreciate you. I didn't know what I had. I didn't understand how good you are. I left home because I didn't appreciate having a father that worked all of his life and turns it all over to me. Let me just tell you, Jesus worked all of his 30 years and then in 3.5 years of ministry just to turn over heaven to you. You didn't deserve it. I didn't deserve it. But he paid a price to cover my sin and your sin, my wrong and your wrong, to clean out my mind and to give me an emotional transformation. He loves you with a perfect love, and I want us to know how much he loves us so that we can benefit by that love and turn around and reach out to all of his other unborn and unsaved children that Heavenly Father wants desperately to come home to him. I have 3 children, as Kathy mentioned, and my greatest joy is knowing that I have a relationship with them. I know that when this life is over, they will also be with me for eternity. Kathy mentioned our friend yesterday. We stopped by, and today there was a burial for a dear minister friend, John Reed, in the Lancaster area. Left behind children, precious children, that are going to miss him desperately. His wife and loved ones, his brothers. Nobody can be that one person that you are to other people. Nobody can be God to you but God. And you don't have to worry about him. Well, how would he feel if I come approaching him for salvation or another answer? The Bible said when the prodigal father saw his son coming from afar off, he ran to the boy. The boy's saying, I'm not worthy. And the father wasn't even listening because he knew all that. He's so glad that his son has finally awakened to want to be with him, to want to go home with him, that he tells the servants, bring the best robe we've got. You know, the one I had made, no one is coming home. And bring those shoes that I went to the cobbler to have made just for him. And you know that beautiful ring that I have, the signet ring for the family? I want you to put it on his finger. He didn't say wash him up and then do it. He covered him up. You can't clean yourself. God has to cleanse you. He has to cover you. He has to wash you. We don't know a lot about the story after this, except they went to the house where the father sent their servants quickly to kill the calf they had been developing and raising and fattening so that when my boy does come home, there's plenty for us to eat. There's not just a little bit, but there's more than enough. We're going to celebrate my son that was dead, that's alive. He was lost and is found. I want you to know that when you get ready to come home, and my greatest prayer right now is that you'll come home today to your father's house. And when you come home, there's more than enough. That cow was fattened up and ready because they were preparing to have a great feast. And they slaughtered it, they butchered it, they barbecued it, they fixed it. And then everybody was celebrating because the boy is starting to realize what kind of a father he has. My prayer in this season, even though we're going through a tough time, not only for the world to find out about how good God is, but I really want all of us as his children to recognize how wonderful he is. He's everything to you. So many times we don't recognize what kind of a God we have. We don't realize how wonderful he is. But as the father went running to that, maybe he was mud-covered, dirt-covered, maybe his garments were ragged, but that's my boy. I made him. I created him, and I want him home. The Bible said he put his arms around him, and he kissed his son. The kiss simply said, son, I know you're sorry, and I'm honored at that. And because you're sorry, you'll be a good servant at the house. You'll be a blessing now. You won't be an ingrate. You won't be somebody just out for what you can get. Now you'll be there for the family and to bring others into the kingdom. Must have been a kind of a funny, unfamiliar feeling, because this time the kiss of the father wasn't just a lip on a cheek. This time it was a welcoming home party, totally and completely forgiven. The father doesn't ask, well, where did you go? Why did you go? What did you do? He didn't do that. He won't ask you that either. Oh, he knows all that, but he's not concerned about where you were. He's concerned because now you've taken God by the hand and you're on your way to the father's house. I want to ask someone today if you're willing to go back home to the father's house. Some of you may not have known a natural father. That's just bluntly, that's a hard thing. I can't go back and see my natural father either. But I can go back to the principles, and I can go back to the love, the feelings. Oftentimes, I can almost hear my father's words ringing in my ear. That's been a long time ago, 50 years ago, when I heard my father the last time with words of love and affirmation, encouragement for the ministry. I can quote some of the things that he said even now. I'm reminded often. But I didn't fully understand how much my father sacrificed, how much he had to give of himself. As Kathy mentioned, Mother's Day's coming up, and I've never done this in my life, to preach Father's Day and Mother's Day within a couple of days apart. But really, to have a mother and a Mother's Day, there has to be a father. And God is saying, I'm going to begin to stir in the middle of all of the tragedy that's going on around the world. I'm stirring up my people. I'm causing my people to wake up and prepare now to go into all the world and to preach the gospel to every creature. They're not creatures. They're God's kids that are unsaved. God's kids that don't know him. I can't imagine having a child that I've never followed up. Had the child and they're gone. I've never seen them, didn't follow. Never had them come back and say, thank you for being my father. I want you to begin to develop these thoughts as we face Mother's Day. Realize how good God, your Heavenly Father, is to give you your father, your mother, because no other two people on the planet could have made you. God put them together, whatever the purpose or whatever the circumstance, because God wanted you, and he wanted you to come home to him. Would you do that today? Would you come home to the Father's house? Not because there's a fatted calf and a barbecue and there's going to be singing and music and dancing. Would you come back because you finally are realizing, as I have begun this week to do, really realizing what kind of a father I have, how good he is. Again, he's everything. If you come home, you'll find that he's healer, he's deliverer, he's savior, he's joy, he's peace, he's everything you need. It all comes from the Father of lights, in whom there is no variableness or shadow of turning, which just means he will never change. He will always love you. Would you let him wash away sin? Would you let him get rid of the hog pen experience? Would you just come home? If so, pray this with me. Father God, I come in the name and the authority of Jesus' promise. You sent your son to die so that I don't have to die. He died so that I could have a relationship with you and I can live with you forever. I receive that relationship right now. I don't understand it. I can't comprehend it. but you loved me with perfect love. While I was yet a sinner, you died, Lord. So right now, I accept your blood to cover my sin. You'll never bring it back up, and I won't go back that way to that sin. By your strength and your direction, I can conquer the past. Holy Ghost, fill me. Sweet Holy Ghost of God, God's Spirit, come and live in me and direct my path. Enable me to be a son worthy, pleasing to such an awesome Father. I receive my forgiveness. I receive the beginning of the filling up of your Spirit, the Ghost of God, the Holy Spirit of the living God living in my life. I accept it and it's done because you never fail. You said anyone that comes, you'll never turn them away. You've been received into the kingdom for eternity. It's time to celebrate. I want to also speak a word for those of you that are going through a physical attack. There's been a number of people calling in. I have this physical ailment, or I've had this situation, the doctor's threat. Just today, someone said this one is going in with lung cancer, and this one's going in with another debilitating disease, or this one's going through something that doctors really can't do much about. But God, our Father, can heal through the blood and the name and the authority of Jesus Christ. So, Father, right now, whatever the circumstance from our friends that are reaching out to you, I speak the word of the Lord in Jesus' name and say to you, agreeing with God's word, be healed, be restored, and be made new. And take a little bit of time, just not try to analyze it, figure it out, but just to receive what he said and believe that you receive that. Be healed and be blessed and encouraged. We claim that for the glory of God in Jesus' name. I know you feel what I'm feeling. Please don't put off going back to the Father's house another day. Come on home. And when you get there, kick off your old shoes and put your feet up on the sofa and just relax. You're at the Father's house, and he's going to take care of you in every need for time and for all of eternity. Just take a few moments to give him praise and glory and honor. I'm just thankful for all of you that are our brothers and sisters in the Lord. We've had such a time apart, and everybody seems to be contacting, saying, when can we get back together? We just miss each other so bad. Yes, we love you. And it's hard, but we're going to be together just very, very quickly, and we're going to let you know when that is. But in advance, to all the mothers, get ready. God is going to prove himself in your house. To every one of you that have been struggling, get ready. All the changes getting ready to take place, and victory is beginning to be established. It's not by might or power, but it's by the grace and the mercy of Jesus Christ. Haley, would you come and share a song of the faith, a song of love? I'm going to ask you to sing along, if you will. Don't drown her out, but sing along with her, if you will. And let's just appreciate the mercy and the grace of our great God that loves us with a perfect love. I love you, Healy.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but how pray. Praise.